Well, if the Democrats take the House, and the 6 or 7 points up in a national poll doesn't really assure that they will, because, as you know, this is done jurisdiction, constituency by constituency, then I would think that the first order of business would be to protect the Robert Mueller report, and the second order of business would be to issue subpoenas for testimony before the House about the president's campaign and about his behavior since being inaugurated. So a lot of energy is going to go into that arena, entirely apart from legislation.
And dare I bring up the I words, the word impeachment. You've written a book on this, so here we are. This is your impeachment book. I mean, first of all, we don't have, there's nothing that has come out of the Mueller investigation so far. There's no evidence yet that the president can be indicted. If damning evidence were to emerge, and you're in a situation where the House is Democrat and the Senate is Republican, what does that mean for impeachment proceedings? Because you still need to have the Senate on board.
That's right. Impeachment is another word for indictment. The House can do that with a bare majority. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if something like that happened. You're quite right in saying, though, that the Mueller investigation has been remarkably, I would say, almost unprecedentedly free of leaks. We don't know what's in that report, and it may be
maybe nothing is in the report.
The real issue is whether or not, after the midterms, if Mueller is dismissed, or if he sends a report to the Attorney General who refuses to release it, whether or not the Congress, particularly the Judiciary Committee, can pry even a summary of that report loose. If the president asserts executive privilege, it'll go to the courts. And it isn't clear that we'll ever see what's in the Mueller report. If you don't ever see what's in the Mueller report, then there'll be no conviction in the Senate. I think that goes without saying.
So that becomes a distant possibility then for the next couple of years. I mean, look, taking a step back, and I'm not American myself, but you know, watching it from afar, you get the sense that the country is extremely polarized. There's literally no common room. There's no dialogue going on between the Democrats and the Republicans because they're sitting at completely opposite ends of the spectrum. Is there any room for there being some form of compromise heading into the second half of the president's term, again, if we do have a split House and a split Senate?
I'm not sure that impression is right. That's probably true of the parties. I think this election will be a realignment election in that the Republican Party will be a Trump party for the foreseeable future, driving a lot of moderate Republicans out, but also solidifying Trump's base. Whether or not they can cooperate in the Congress, I think, is going to be a very difficult question. But the country itself, at least my sense of it is really not that polarized. I think there's a large center group that's just tired, just exhausted by this all this quarreling.
I mean, you say that, but then 90% of the Trump base don't want to watch mainstream media. The same goes for the liberal media. They don't want to watch the same media that that represents the so-called the Trump philosophy on life. Yeah. There's a lot of distrust out there. You hear it. The rhetoric is extremely angry. You've got several incidents over the last couple of weeks with the pipe bombs, with the mass shootings. I mean, the country seems to be in a very dire state at this point in time. And there's something like this is an opportunity, and the economists were leading with this weekend. They're saying this is an opportunity for things to change and for that divide between the two sides to actually be healed. So do you see any optimism coming out of these elections that this actually may happen and may lead to something more positive for the country?
That might have happened if this had been what's known as a wave election, if there'd been a change, but I think what you'll see instead is, just as you said, the Democrats in the House, the Republicans maybe picking up one or two seats in the Senate, and a continued sort of gridlock on Capitol Hill. But I wouldn't extrapolate from what happens in Washington to the larger public. My sense of it is that the great mass of people, even if, as you say, we tend to watch the things that reinforce our own prejudices and opinions, I think the great mass of our people are dispirited about government, but not dispirited about the country and its direction.
Hey everybody, it's Hadley Gamble from our new CNBC Middle East Bureau in Abu Dhabi. Thanks for stopping by. Now to watch more, you can try one of the videos that just popped up on your screen. And don't forget to subscribe.